anyone who's interested may join the chorus and help us sing on key. This morning's platform, Worker Cooperative, Sustainable and Growing, with speaker Joe Rinehart. Joe is a cooperative developer and advocate for undermining economic inequality through shared ownership. How refreshing. He is a former worker and owner at Firestorm Cafe and Books in Asheville, North Carolina, and instructor at Appalachian State University. He recently left his position as Director of Cooperative Development at the Democracy at Work Institute, where he helped guide and support a coalition that garnered New York City's groundbreaking $1.2 million investment in worker cooperatives. Prior to his time as a cooperative worker owner, he completed a master's degree in industrial technology at Appalachian University with a focus on small-scale technologies that empower communities and protect the environment. Please welcome today's speaker, Joe Rinehart.
Hey, good morning. Thanks so much for having me.
Good morning.
I'm thrilled to be here. I was like, oh, how do I introduce myself? I'm not used to speaking so much for years. Oh, is that
yes.
Necessary?
Yes.
Necessary. Brilliant. I will not avoid the mic then. Thanks so much for having me. And I was, how long should I introduce myself? How should I introduce myself? But that was a great introduction. Thanks. I wanted to talk today. This is going to be, I don't like being behind the podium, by the way. I'm so thrilled to get a chance to talk today about re-examining how we think about building an ethical economy and a more just and fair economy. And I think we've become so used to thinking about it in terms of having that economy, having an economy dedicated to creating structural inequalities, and then having to constantly work to battle and rein in that economy through strikes and protests. And we've really become used to thinking about an economy where we have to constantly work in this frame of people versus capital. And that's the story we tell ourselves, it's people versus profit. And that's, today that's very much true. And the underlying story there really is that it's people with very little, it's not just people without capital, it's people with incredible ingenuity and very little capital versus very few people with very much capital that builds a drastically unfair and sort of unlivable economy, not for virtually everyone, that creates this cycle of growing income and inequality that we're today involved in. And so I want to talk about how do we think about changing the structures of that economy so that we shift from one that trends towards economic inequality to one that trends towards economic fairness. And I think, there's no structural, or we can't have structures so great that they'll prevent us from having to be good people, but we can have structures that support us in being good people and having an economy that works for everyone. So shifting from maybe people versus capital to people with capital versus just capital. And I think the reason I'm so passionate about this really traces back to the time I did spend in not just Western North Carolina, but also Appalachia and the coal fields of Appalachia working lightly, but with groups of incredibly dedicated Appalachians who were some of the most ingenious and ingenuitive and smart and really knowledgeable of the way the world works. But because of the way that culture has been structured over the past 200 years, and for folks who don't know, there's just been a scourge of first mining and labor exploitation, and then mountaintop removal, which I was working with many others to help stop and stem, and it's finally starting to slow down, mostly due to the shift in the global economy, and unfortunately less due to our work, I think. But for folks who don't know that part of the world that really deliberately had its ability to meet its own needs stripped away, that people in Appalachia don't own the mountains. The mountains have all been bought up sort of a century ago, and the rights to the most productive parts of your land, the minerals, and that have all been bought up, and so they don't really own the natural capital around them, even though they're the ones living in it and experiencing the effects of having it being exploited. And then over the last century, the coal industry and this sort of allies have deliberately stripped away all the capital from that region, all its ability to produce for itself anything but coal, its ability to be independent and self-sufficient. And in doing so, they've really created a system where we can't, like, there's no winning. It was sort of a deeply depressing experience to work in those communities, because they're just, no matter how hard you fought, how smart the people were, without that access to capital, and I think it was really impossible to stop the tide of destruction and depopulation. And I have some really good friends who now live in New York City, and I'm like, I'd love to go back to West Virginia, but there's nothing there. So from there I went to Appalachian State, studied sort of technologies that make people independent, and came to the conclusion that it wasn't a technological problem, but really it was a problem with the economy and the questions that we ask in the economy right now. Right? So right now our economy and the structures fundamentally ask this question, like, how can this company create the most return for its company's investors? Right? That's the key question that any public company and most private companies that grow large enough are forced to ask. And instead, I think, and there's a whole set of systems and structures that arise from that. And instead, what if we change the questions that our companies are asking? Became a really important question to me. What if we ask, how can this community create the most just community around it? That's supposed to say, what company? How can this company create the most just community around it? Like, what if that's the fundamental question that the company's asking? Then it has to not just ask, how can it meet the needs of its customers? That, you know, I think one of the biggest challenges on our side of working in worker cooperatives and employee-owned, any sort of community ownership, is saying, as much as we love to do the exact right thing all the time, we can only really, we have to be in that market and compete and meet the needs of our customers. But beyond that, how do we create the most local jobs, create the best jobs possible, or root wealth locally? And what does it look like to really create companies that are asking that set of questions? And questions around building our democracy and building people's capacity. What does that look like? Rather than this question of how can this company create the most return for its investors. If you ask that first question, you get a structure for your company that looks like this, where the founders or the shareholder, the founders go out and recruit a lot of shareholders and sell off the equity little by little, and those shareholders elect a board of directors that really holds the management accountable to extracting as much value as possible from the communities and the world around it and from the employees there, right? The idea there is to move as much value up that chain as possible. But if you ask that other set of questions, or if you ask, how can this company be as good as possible? If that's what you're really trying to create, you get another structure where people who own the business, who work in them, are the shareholders who own that one share of stock and vote together to elect a board of directors who then, oversees management, whose job it is to keep an eye on the market and making sure this company keeps good jobs out there, but is always accountable to the worker owners who can fire the management. And those worker owners, in many ways, it's much different to think about if the factory in your community is owned by the workers who work there. Those are, people able to go into a community meeting and say, hey, I'm a business owner here, and if that factory is exploiting the environment, if that company isn't behaving ethically, there's not, a few points of entry, a few points for you as a local citizen to complain to shareholders 1,000 miles away. If the shareholders are your brother, your sister, your neighbor, like that company, like just your ability to say, hey, you're polluting, you're destroying the environment, you're not treating us well, you're not treating this community well. It's a fundamentally different relationship with the companies in your community. And that's really sort of what I and many, many other people in New York City and around the country and the world are working to create. It's becoming increasingly clear that we know from the last 50 years of history that it's a viable model even to compete in the global economy. There's worker cooperatives in Spain that are 100,000 plus members. It's this Mondragon is the seventh largest cooperative, or seventh largest company in Spain is a worker-owned cooperative. And if you look at the economic inequality indicators for that region, the Basque region where Mondragon is based, it's one of the most equal, it's the most equal place in Spain and one of the most equal places in Europe. And it has an unemployment rate of about half of that of the rest of Spain. Largely because this company is dedicated to returning a profit, not to its sort of the broader shareholders, but to its community and its workers. But what does that look like in New York City? And I'll just, I like to listen to tell stories more than anything. It looks like Beyond Care, which is a child care cooperative that raised out of Sunset Park, and they provide nanny services to the wealthy people in Park Slope and other places. But through this cooperative, these 40 Latina women, and with the help of the Center for Family Life at Sunset Park, have transformed their sort of precarious job into one that has a solid contract with time off and clear benefits and clear pay rates. And they've created a company that, instead of being one Latina woman, often undocumented, who can't, if the employer doesn't pay her, that's really not anyone. No one's going to be concerned with that. But if the employee doesn't pay the cooperative member now, there's a legal entity that chases down that employer and says, no, actually, you signed a contract because we helped our cooperative members create a contract, or we as cooperative members created a contract. And it's really, and beyond that, they've created not just a better value and a better place to work, but they've also enabled, through scaling and growing up to 40 women, they've been able to take more ESL classes, so they're better able to participate in the broader society. And these women take so many more early childhood education and childhood development classes. So it's not just about improving the quality of work for the cooperative members, but it's also improved the quality of childcare. And I think that's one of the things that is just a huge trend in cooperatives is they, in doing so, they improve not just in forming cooperatives and operating cooperative business. They don't just offer an opportunity for the workers, but they offer better services to the community. And we'll take a look at that later as well. But if you look, or you can look at Build with Prospect, where your normal construction worker will never own a construction company, except when the construction company owner says, I'm going to retire in a few years, and my employees have built this company alongside of me. I want to be rewarded for the work I put in. I'm going to sell my company, but I'm going to work with the local cooperative community to sell my company to its employees. And that's what Jeremy did. He's the fellow in the lower left who you might imagine would own a construction company, especially one emphasizing green construction in Brooklyn. And the people around him all also own that company, and they're not people you would imagine who would be building equity and building assets through entrepreneurship, but they are now because they've been able to buy a share of this company, and it's not something that's necessarily for everyone in the company, and a few people left when they sold the company to the employees, but by and large, it's been great both for the company and for the workers. Or Equal Exchange, which is some people have probably seen Equal Exchange products around their coffee, tea, fair trade company, and not only do they provide good working conditions, I think my friends all get 5 weeks paid vacation a year. How do I take 5 weeks of paid vacation? What to do with myself? But they also provide an anchor for 12 different cooperative networks around the world, making really long-term relationships with those cooperatives of coffee farmers, chocolate farmers, cocoa farmers, and tea growers. And so they provide not just a better way of working for their workers in the U.S., but a really solid anchor for long-term, meaningful economic development in these cooperative communities, or in these communities of cooperatives. And so those are just a few examples. And then the largest one in the United States is Cooperative Home Care Associates. And I was reading today that the New York City Ethical Culture Society helped to found the Visiting Nurses Service, which was a critical partner in saying we want to improve job quality amongst home care providers in 1982, I think. And as in partnership with the Community Service Society and a bunch of amazing people and funders, Visiting Nurses Service was the key contractor that helped Cooperative Home Care Associates get off the ground. So this company, which is now 2,500 low-income workers who are more highly paid and have more equity and better health care and better working conditions and much, much lower turnover in the home care industry, where turnover can reach 80% a year, is now. And what's interesting here, I think it's instructive that this company is not just about improving the quality of work for its employees, it's 2,500 employees, but there's more than 80,000 home health carriers in New York City. And through owning this company and saying, we're going to create better jobs, and in doing so, deliver more higher quality health care, they've raised the legal standards in working with the union, working with SEIU, they've raised the legal standard for the minimum wage for home health care workers here in New York for 80,000 people. And they've around the country instituted better practices in all sorts of different companies, all sorts of different home care companies. So they really changed the landscape for tens of thousands of workers and hundreds of thousands of workers over time. And that's sort of a demonstration of the power of this model. It doesn't just treat the workers in the company well, but it can treat them. When you're using sort of community ownership and cooperative ownership to drive forward broader social goals, you have impacts that are far, far magnified beyond just that small, 25, most of the three other cooperatives are all about 25 or 40 members, but you have impacts far beyond that. And I want to sort of say that this is not, this idea that communities should be owning the businesses that are in them and that they should be answering those questions and creating structures that trend towards economic fairness is not just about worker ownership, but it's about community ownership as well. So in New York right now, there's a huge community development credit union movement. If people are familiar with credit unions, these credit unions, like the Brooklyn Cooperative Federal Credit Union, are dedicated to offering banking services and offering community development strategies to communities that are underserved by the banking industry. And if they were served by the banking industry's first thought would be, how can we extract as much capital from that community as possible? But instead, the credit union asks, how do we help our members achieve the most financial health? Or the newly founded New York Real Estate Investment Cooperative, which aims to, it's pretty new, but it aims to not just impact, where we normally think of housing cooperatives or real estate cooperatives, which is in impacting residential, but also addressing some of these challenges around how do we create access to space for a vibrant culture here in New York City, and where and vibrant culture accessible to everyone, where in a place of real estate rents or commercial real estate rents just going through the roof, and many community organizations, many even reasonable local businesses being driven out in favor of, you either have to have a Starbucks or a Dunkin' Donuts because you have to pay that rent. Only chains can afford to pay the rent. What if we decommodified and moved away from simply pursuing real estate as a profit-driven enterprise and said, no, real estate, we have to all have access to commercial real estate, and we have to make community decisions around how commercial real estate is used. Yeah, you have to pay the upkeep on the building. You have to build new buildings every once in a while. But what if the primary driver was the community and not the real estate investors? But what that takes really is to create a huge pool of capital, and a capital that is uninterested in pursuing the highest profit globally around the world, but capital interested in building the best community locally. And so there are hundreds of people right now in New York City who have joined this New York State Real Estate Investment Cooperative, and who are, dozens who are working to bring the first investment to fruition. And beyond that, there's many, many low equity housing incomes. We had this huge conversation about affordable housing in New York City, but it stops. The whole conversation has stopped short of, goes to how do we make affordable housing in New York City so that people can be perpetually pay into an asset that doesn't generate them any wealth or generate them any savings over time. Whereas we have a solution in low-income housing or low-equity housing cooperatives where you can't triple or quadruple your housing investment in a few years or even in 20 years. But what you can do is you can take out a mortgage on a low-income or a low low-cost housing apartment that you'll pay off eventually, and then it'll be an asset that you own, and you can either live there and not pay rent, or not pay your mortgage anymore. You can sell it at, you know, 3 or 4% a year. And so there are all these opportunities to create the structures in our economy that are not just about sort of either, in the case of affordable housing, managing our economy that trends towards extraction, but are about creating an economy bent on creating fairness. And that are sort of the broad outlines. And I will just say that it was my great pleasure to work for 3 years from the Democracy at Work Institute, and in doing so we helped found, and this is a growing movement, we helped found the New York City Coalition for Worker Cooperatives that has now grown to secure more than $3 million in investment from the city in New York City in cooperative development funding. And really, that's the big headline that everyone is interested in, but I think what's amazing is that the city is now beginning to turn its interest to worker cooperatives and say, more broadly, how do we use worker cooperatives as a tool for equitable economic development? And beyond that, we've started to see settlement houses and other nonprofits sort of begin to support that work and begin to be interested in how do we help our members join worker cooperatives. And so it's a really growing environment movement. There's over 30 worker cooperatives in New York City now, and many more employee-owned businesses of other forms. And there's a sort of growing movement towards saying, no, we need to think about our democracy not just being about being able to access wealth and build wealth democratically. And I hope people, that's more or less my presentation. I think if people, if people have questions, I'm happy to answer them. Is that the usual?
I'm going to ask Dan to pass the microphone. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Would you like to do that?
Nationwide insurance is a cooperative. So many of the early insurance companies were created because people needed insurance and it wasn't, so they insured each other. They like insured each other against risk. And so it's been for a long time, like for the first half of the second half of the 19th century and the first bit of the 20th century, it wasn't until progressivism sort of said the solution to capitalist greed is government restraint. And I think we battle greed by changing that to say the solution to capitalist greed is by creating a different system, and one that we start creating right now that meets people's needs right now. That's my long answer to that question.
I'm going to ask a question, getting back to coal for a moment.
Mm-hmm.
So, speaking from an environmental lens now, of the three fossil fuels, coal seems to be the one that's on its way out the fastest. How might that impact the opportunity in West Virginia and other coal-producing states to be training and maybe to form worker cooperatives around alternative energies or renewable energies? Anything that you're aware of?
Yeah, there's lots of people working on it. There's a project called Hub West Virginia. But I think the challenge there is equity. The people in West Virginia and the communities in West Virginia have been so stripped of any form of equity, either in the form of human equity, even in terms of people, just the brain drain is remarkable. And in terms of access to any form of like capital that's enough to really magnify the labor of people in order to make it valuable enough for them to live and attract people to buy what they'll have to sell some other product or energy. And so I think if you're interested in that, the best supporting these reinvestment and sort of the fair treatment of coal mining communities, and especially asking to be support cooperatives, but when it comes up with this sort of treating, I think it's the power plant that Obama has, it's the reinvestment in West Virginia and coal. That's, to me, is really the critical. It can happen, but the critical piece is equity.
There's an article in this weekend's Times about cases coming before the Supreme Court when it reconvenes that could, depending on their decisions, weaken unions, labor unions, terribly. Is there any movement afoot that you know of to combat that, to deal with that?
Yeah, there's a lot of, one of the things that has really been amazing in the last few years is that the union movement has started to embrace worker cooperatives as a potential solution and as an ally. So if you look at 1199, 1199 and Cooperative Home Care Associates here in New York are allies at the state level in fighting for fair treatment of home care workers. And then if you the clearinghouse for all the information about unions and cooperatives is a site called One Worker, One Vote, which is, there's a movement afoot in Cincinnati to start a number of unionized union worker cooperatives where the worker cooperatives are actually partially funded by and owned by the unions. So there's all sorts of different sort of tentative supports growing. It takes a long time to grow connections between movements, and for a long time, worker cooperatives were about owning capital and were small, and workers were about challenging capital. And so they sort of grew apart, but now they're growing back together in a ton of different ways.
Because of my various activities, I spend a lot of time on 14th Street, on West 72nd Street, on Columbus Avenue, and I have never, in the 40 years I've lived in New York City, seen so many for rent signs. Businesses that have gone out of business, especially if the mom and pop. The only stores that I see affording those rents are the big chains, which sell nothing in the neighborhood that is of any value, no food, no whatnot. But I really am very depressed. What I see is the real estate industry is Goliath, and David was an excellent shop. Now I don't know how we can combat a real estate industry that is so entrenched and is so controlled by the government. What are your suggestions? This real estate industry is just cancerous.
I mean, I think this is, so it's, the thing about New York City that is amazing to me is that it's still very machine-oriented politics, and which is maybe bad, but also like if you can deliver a rally or a vote of like a few hundred, or a calls of a few hundred people, people are pretty open to movement, and pretty shocked by that. And I think that's a really great opportunity. Like, so we were advocating for the Worker Cooperative, bill before city council, we would turn out 100 people and they would be like, very impressed. And so I think there's a lot of opportunity in acting in these, like, in getting engaged in the politics of real estate in these very small places where it's like, oh, that's surprising that people are paying attention. Because the real estate industry really thrives by people like not paying attention and not being engaged. So if we start asking for real estate, if we start asking for commercial real estate, rent stabilization, like that might be possible. What is possible is that is to purchase, and it's not going to be a huge solution for everything right now, but this New York City Real Estate Investment Cooperative, the idea that we ought to be having commercial real estate owned by a cooperative and that pays, you know, return on equity, but where the fundamental decisions about what goes in what goes into those spaces are controlled by the community who lives around them, is really, I think, the best solution I've heard. And there are some successful real estate investment cooperatives, including one in Minneapolis, St. Paul. Yes, Minneapolis, St. Paul, that's been really successful at revitalizing a community. It's not, I think, one of the challenges of doing work around building alternative structures that it's a long game, right? If we buy an apartment building right now and turn it into cooperatives, the rents are going to be very similar to what the rents are right now, unfortunately. But on the plus side, the rents are going to stay roughly the same for the next 20 years. And so, yes, it is going to be hard. Like any of these roads are hard ones to walk down. But if you can imagine, if there's student housing cooperatives now that, oh, the rent is like $300 a month or $200 a month to rent a what is functionally a dorm room. There's no college campus in the country where you can rent a dorm room for $200 a month. But because they bought real estate ages ago, and because they paid off their mortgage in 10 years, 5 years, suddenly they're able to keep the rent similar and have the rent grow up much more slowly than it would in just a market-driven economy. So there's no simple solution.
I'd like to know how do you deal with the problem of efficiency and inefficiency in cooperatives? You know, one of the complaints against cooperatives is that inefficiency develops in a place for a collapse, a system collapse. Whereas, you know, in capitalist system, you know, they get rid of the inefficiency.
Yeah, that's something that we've learned an amazing amount about in the last 100 years of cooperative creation. I think it requires a real recognition of those problems, but also recognition that every system has problems. No one says, let's throw out private ownership of real estate because it exploited a few people all the time. And so I think it's easy to say, oh, the system has some challenges, let's throw it out and stick with the mainstream system. That's sort of the benefit that a mainstream system has. But on the other hand, I think creating secondary, one of the things that we've learned from more successful cooperative economies overseas is creating secondary cooperatives that are just, their only job is to support cooperatives that give good board trainings and that you have to be a member of. So the board like really knows what it's doing, and having that like technical assistance available. And then truthfully, like, most of what I see is that sort of cooperatives get entrenched, the board, the power structure gets entrenched. So forcing board turnover is a good way. I could do a whole workshop on like governance system design for an ongoingly vital and entrepreneurial cooperative, but there are solutions that involve sort of engagement and turnover.
Thank you. was interested by your discussion of the building prospect problem, pooling funds and being able to buy out the previous owner from the owner. Yeah. I could see it being a problem. I don't know how it was dealt with there because I was referring to the building prospect case and wondering how workers, all of whom had, had small amounts of capital, could pool enough capital to actually have enough to satisfy an owner who really was after money. One possibility, which could be problematic, would be for people to go out and borrow the funds, which means that they have the home capital, which they then burden with loans. Other than that, what was the experience with there? Was it a question of people borrowing and using that?
I think it's a question of, there's two things that usually happen. One is that the owner self-finances a fair amount, between 25 and 75% of the buyout price is self-financed. So it goes from saying, here's the buyout price, give me 25%, I'm gonna self-finance 75%. And that's where we're at now. Where we want to be is actually there's an existing business is with a knowledgeable workforce is a valuable asset that you can borrow against. It's actually a pretty fundable loan. What you need is equity. You need this, someone has to put skin in the game. And so one thing that the cooperative movement is really engaged in right now is organizing equity. And it's not about loans, but so there's an organization here in New York City called The Working World that is a loan fund that also works closely with cooperatives to move to help the employees really be effective worker owners and make it a great business. So yeah, they're involved in organizing equity. The Dog Site Work Institute is involved in organizing sort of impact investors, because impact investors are like, oh, I can get 3 or 4% on a loan or on my equity bond. That's fine by me. And if I can say I'm having all these other impacts, they're interested in that solution. And so there's a world of capital being organized. And I think that's something that the Cooperative Fund of New England is another, and North Country Cooperative Development Fund also take investments from individuals as a five-year term investment with a fixed interest rate.
Last question.
I was wondering if you could explain the real estate co-op that's happening. I saw an invitation to join for $10 or something like that. And I don't really understand the membership of that. I have friends who've lived in a very small co-op in the West Village for 75 plus years. And there are very few members. And someone passed away and a distant relative inherited the property and used a huge sum of money to fight the co-op and drain them of all of their assets. And they have no free legal advice. So the next time that happens, they're going to lose it. So how does all of that work? If you're really a member and the size of the organization, the size of the cooperative, and how do you, what's the benefit of becoming a member of something that you're not really a part of, per se?
The New York City Real Estate Investment Cooperative, it's still sort of forming its bylaws and the structure, and that $10 is really about showing interest. But I think what will happen eventually is that there'll be two classes of shares, right? I'll buy a $10 share, and I'll get a vote on how the whole thing is run, right? I won't ever expect that $10 to get very much bigger. Maybe when I stop my membership, it's $11, but I get a vote on how the whole thing is run, and I show support, right? And then there'll be classes of shares that don't get to speak, and those will be fairly expensive, and they'll be about investing money in New York City real estate and getting a return. But not a huge return. And then there'll be a set of communities that are able to actually, or there'll be a local community group that's able to say, oh, you're investing in our community, we're gonna put together an advisory board that guides what goes into this commercial real estate. So that's how I think the whole thing will happen. What you're talking about is this idea, and I think it's worth noting that cooperatives, cooperation as an economic concept is something that works very, very well. You can tell because rich people do it all the time. If you look at every, the American Beef Board is functionally a cooperative. next year in your country club, you could elect a board member. They're not going to say it's a cooperative. It's a cooperative for rich people. And so, you know, what we get told that, you know, cooperation of that, capitalism is about competition. Capitalism is about cooperation, or what makes it work is cooperation amongst wealthy people. We're not supposed to know. And but I think what it takes is turning, and so there's cooperatives all over the country that aren't aimed at changing economic systems. But cooperatives are a really important tool for changing economic systems if you point them in that direction, and if you do it structurally. So I think, and what happened when all these real estate cooperatives got formed, all the individual real estate cooperatives got formed in New York City in the 70s, most of those were actually focused on not changing the way the economy was structured, but creating a market for real estate in New York that simply didn't exist. So that's one of the cooperatives that your friends are unfortunately a part
no,
of.
No, theirs is from the early 1900s.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well,
it's the last, one of the last standing ready to fall. But so you're talking about it kind of as a Kickstarter in a way.
The New York City Real Estate Investment Co-op?
Yeah.
It's a little bit of a Kickstarter right now.
Okay,
yeah.
Cool.
But
thank
it's,
you.
But
I just didn't understand.
Their next meeting is on the 28th, and you can go and join and find out more. They're on Facebook and the internet and all that stuff.
We have one last follow-up question.
Oh.
We'd like to follow up and actually do things when we get new information, so go ahead.
Thank you. Who do we bedevil in New York City government to start to attack this real estate monster?
Oh, you know, I don't know. I think that is a question beyond my knowledge. I think I don't know that it's the people who would know that are the people at the real estate investment co-op.
If you follow the money, it's state assembly, given how many were just arrested.
Yeah, right.
They're all bribed for there, so
but I would say in terms of following up and doing things, I think you can there are a lot of opportunities to really think about how you engage with the cooperative economy. You can think about it as a creative person, and the real estate investment cooperative is always looking for people to help spread their message and figure out how to better express their message, or as a creative entrepreneur, or if you know people who are entrepreneurs who want to sell their business, it's a big problem selling your business, and there's lots of ways to sell your business to your employees that it really works. Or I'll say just a couple of great organizations to join or support are the U.S. Federation of Worker Cooperatives, which is the National Worker Cooperative Association, and they plug people into political action, and the New York City Network of Worker Cooperatives, which is an affiliate. If you sign up for their email list, you'll get all the, hey, call your assembly person or call your city council person today about supporting worker cooperatives.
New York City Network of
Worker Cooperatives. Making the hire.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So every Sunday we share our collection with an organization, nonprofit in nature, that shares our values. And when we have an outside speaker, we allow them to choose the organization. Today's shared charity is Center for Family Life. Center for Family Life is a program of SCO Family Services, a neighborhood-based family and social service organization with deep roots in Sunset Park, Brooklyn, as we learned this morning. Their mission is to promote positive outcomes for children, adults, and families in Sunset Park through the provision of comprehensive range of neighborhood-based family and social services. Please give generously to both this organization and the New York Society. Thank you.